shockwave is a key story point in that that's what upsets the escape sub, but they're never, you know, we changed it to they're never in such jeopardy that they go inside the explosion or they would die. So this is a combination of that shockwave where the air is separated out of the water with our practical wet for wet explosions, our dry for wet explosions where we shot real explosions at 300 frames a second dangling from the top of a 150-foot crane in a rock quarry at night, and our air mortar explosions, which are shot in a 25-foot deep tank and filling the air with various kinds of smoke and lighting, and all to mix together into just the perfect blend to deliver the impact and drama that we're trying to do.
You a religious man, Norm?
Atheist. Not classical.
Visual effects is a lot of hard work. It's a lot of planning. It's a lot of talking. It's a lot of standing next to people and trying to convince them that this approach is the best approach. And it's a lot of listening in the end to, in order to execute and give the director exactly what it is that he was bargaining for. The power of visual effects, there's nothing we can't do. And that's frightening. Every visual effect is a living, breathing thing and changes as soon as the cameras and the set and the actors or the miniatures or the explosion is present. So if you are looking for an entry-level job in the visual effects end of the business, there's a wide variety of places you can get into it from. If you can draw well, you can get an entry-level position drawing storyboards, which is a wonderful way to start because it gives you exposure to a lot of people you wouldn't normally meet. It gives you an overview to a wide variety of techniques and effects. And it also allows you a certain freedom in trying in learning to design shots and see why some shots work really well and some shots don't work so well. Other ways into the business is to go to work for one of the large companies and as a what they call, you know, entry-level roto artist, where you are hand painting frame by frame, cleaning up shots, cleaning up mat work like that. It's important to be able to have a vast knowledge of how everything was done before it got easy to do. It's important to know how they did them in the 40s and the 50s, even the 30s. You know, for a while, doing things digitally has just been the hot trend, but you could do them using photochemical means just as effectively, some of them, and a whole heck of a lot cheaper. You have to have a vast knowledge of film history so that you can solve a vast array of problems to the best advantage being look and cost. Another way to do it is to have gone out and made some really neat visual effects, little projects on your own, and being able to take them in and say, see what I've done. That reel can help you either become a supervisor, or if your goal is to jump on a computer and actually do put the shots together for a while, that reel can get you into that thing. It's probably the number one tool that I would use today. However, if you can't do good effects, if you do really cheesy looking effects, they don't give you points for trying. You know, to create a visual effects takes more than one guy. It takes the on-set crew, it takes the pre-production crew, and it takes the post-production crew. So every single effect on the film is representative of the work of about 250 talented individuals who either stayed up for days on end in front of a computer, stayed up for days on end drawing storyboards or gathering equipment, or stayed up for days on end on a set in order to deliver the latest version of whatever it is the director came up. So I hope that you come away from this experience knowing a little bit more about visual effects, having a little greater appreciation for the blood, the sweat, and tears that goes into it, and thinking that, wow, this is a pretty fun thing to do.